Hi, I'm Mike Lacona. Ever since the second century, skeptics have been pointing out contradictions, differences, discrepancies in the Gospels as a major reason for distrusting them as historical sources about Jesus. Now, a lot can be said about this, but in the next few moments, I'm going to look at one area that will shed light on why there actually are differences in the Gospels. It doesn't do any good for us to deny that they exist, because they certainly do, as a very careful reading of texts that appear in stories that appear in two or more Gospels will clearly reveal. So let's go on and look at why, at least some reasons, why there are differences in the Gospels. It's important to recognize that the Gospels belong to the genre of Greco-Roman biography. At least this is what most New Testament scholars today believe. Why Greco-Roman rather than Jewish biography? Well, for some unknown reason, the Jews did not write biographies of their sages in the days of Jesus. So if the gospel writers were writing according to a literature of their day, Greco-Roman biography was the only game in town. Now, when we look at the rest of the biblical literature, we identify that, for the most part, they wrote according to genres of their days. So they used wisdom literature for Proverbs and Ecclesiastes. Psalms was songs. You had the historical books of the Old Testament. You have the prophetic books of the Old Testament. And then when we come to the New Testament, we have letters. So that was a particular genre. We have the book of Acts, which is considered to be historiography, and there were certain rules for that. And then you have Revelation, which is considered to be apocalyptic literature. Moreover, most scholars regard the letter to the Hebrews as a homily, a sermon. So what we want to do is we want to study the biblical literature according to the genre in which it was written. So it would be odd for just about all of the biblical literature to be written according to genres of their day and then have the Gospels exempted from that. Well, so if the gospel authors were writing according to the genre most appropriate for that day, it would have been Greco-Roman biography. And in Greco-Roman biography, as well as historiography, you were allowed to take certain compositional moves, some flexibility in the way that you reported events. Some of these we have to infer based on examples we see in the literature. However, in other cases, we actually have ancient literature that instructs students how to write. I'm thinking of Lucian of the middle of the second century in his book, How to Write History. And then we have glimpses, hints from Thucydides and Polybius and others like that. Of real interest are what we can call compositional textbooks. And we have these, the earliest ones we have, come from the first century, the same time in which the Gospels were written. These had what were called progymnasmata, which is a fancy Greek term for preliminary exercises. And these, with these handbooks, these the students who were, at this time, usually mid-teenaged boys, from wealthy and aristocratic ranks, and they were learning. This was the third stage in their educational process. And so they were learning how to write, and they had particular exercises. Now, we do have these progymnasmata handbooks or compositional textbooks from antiquity that have survived. But as I mentioned, Theon is from the first century, Quintilian's from the first century. The first four that I have here on the screen wrote in Greek, Quintilian wrote in Latin. So I want to take a moment, I want to look at some of the exercises that were given. Typically, what they would do, and let's just refer to Theon here, he would take a passage, a paragraph from Thucydides, who wrote centuries before that, but who was highly revered as a Greek historian. And he wrote a history of the Peloponnesian War, in which Athens was trying to take over all of Greece, Corinth, Syracuse, Sparta, and bring it under her umbrella, and it resulted in a war that was just about as long as the Vietnam War. Finally, Athens was defeated. Thucydides came from Athens, so he was on the losing side, and he wrote the history of the Peloponnesian War. So sometimes when you hear people say history is written by the winners, this is one of the greatest examples of that not being true, or at least being an exception to that rule. So Theon would provide a passage from Thucydides, and then he would show how to alter that, sometimes in the interest of artistically improving the text, where there was awkward grammar or something. So let's look at a few examples. What I'm going to do, though, is rather than take the long paragraph from Thucydides, I'm just going to take a statement and give you an example how it might work. So one way of altering the text would be through altering the syntax. And syntax means the grammatical structure. So you just rearrange the words. And this was quite easy to do in Greek, a lot more so than in English. Because in English, we typically put the subject first, and then the verb, and then either the direct object or indirect object after that. But in Greek, it didn't work that way. You could do it that way, or you could put the direct object first, followed by the indirect object, followed by the subject, followed by the verb. It could be in any number of orders. So a sentence simply as, "Today, I watched the video." If you were to translate that into Greek, there may be literally 200 ways in which to say this in Greek. So let's just say in English, if I were to change the syntax of the sentence, "Today I watched a video," it would change to say, "I watched a video today." It's pretty simple. All I did was, you know, I took and swapped the words a little bit. It still makes sense in English, but I just changed it a little bit. Maybe I could, instead of changing the syntax, I could change it by addition. So instead of saying, "Today I watched a video," I said, "Today I watched a video and learned how better to read ancient literature." So what I did by adding to the original thought, I gave some thoughts that would clarify actually what I was watching. It didn't change the meaning necessarily. It actually clarified and gave us more information. But let's suppose the original said, "Today I watched a video." The second would be the addition, the paraphrasing of it by addition. Here's another example. You could do it and alter a text by subtraction. So instead of saying, "Today I watched a video," one could write, "I watched a video." And you just take the "today" out of there. Or I could do it by substitution. So instead of saying, "Today I watched a video," I would say, "Today I viewed a video," or "Today I observed a video." So I'm just putting a synonym in there. Another way I could change the statement is by changing the statement to a question. So instead of saying, "Today I watched a video," I could say, "Did you know that I watched a video today?" I could also change a statement to an exclamation. So instead of saying, "Today I watched a video," I could say, "Oh, I'm so glad I watched that video today." So it doesn't really change the thought, but it changes the way I say it. And maybe in the context, this could be considered an improvement for means of entertainment or just to make a point stronger. That would be the purpose in doing this, to make it a better read or to make the point clearer. Or I could create a dialogue, and this was common as well. So instead of saying, "Today I watched a video," I'd say, I'd write it as, "Well, what did you do today?" And I'd answer, "I watched a video." "Oh, well, how was it?" "Great. I learned how better to read ancient literature." So again, I just created a dialogue. I said the same thing, I just said it differently. And a lot of times people would rather they can pay attention more if there's a dialogue going on, especially those of us like myself with attention deficit disorder. Let me give you an example in the New Testament of this occurring. And there's plenty of examples of this in the ancient literature, the ancient non-biblical literature, but let's just look at a few examples of these things occurring in the New Testament. We start off with the healing, Jesus healing the man with the withered hand. Now, this story appears in all three of the Gospels, all three of the Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And the story comes in all three of them. It immediately follows the story of Jesus' disciples picking grain on the Sabbath and the Jewish leaders challenging them and taking offense at this and saying, why are your disciples, Jesus? Why are your disciples picking grain on the Sabbath? And Jesus basically says, chill out, guys. I'm Lord of the Sabbath. So right after that, we find Jesus in a synagogue on the Sabbath, and he's going to heal this man with the withered hand. So the point to be made here is any differences that we're going to observe in just a moment aren't the result of this being a separate occasion. This is most certainly the same occasion. So let's look at the stories. Let's look at how Luke and Mark report the story. Luke says it this way, and Mark says it pretty much the same way. So I'm just going to quote Luke. On another Sabbath, Jesus entered the synagogue and was teaching. And a man was there whose right hand was withered. And the scribes and the Pharisees watched him. The Pharisees watched him to see whether he would heal on the Sabbath so that they might find a reason to accuse him. But he knew their thoughts. Jesus knew their thoughts. And he said to the man with the withered hand, come and stand here. And he rose and stood there. And Jesus said to them, I ask you, is it lawful on the Sabbath to do good or to do harm, to save life or to destroy it? And after looking around at them all, he said to him, stretch out your hand. And he did, and his hand was healed. But they were filled with fury and discussed with one another what they might do to Jesus. So just to summarize this up, he's in the synagogue on the Sabbath. The Pharisees are there, and they want to see if Jesus will heal on the Sabbath. There's a man with the withered hand there, and they're going to watch Jesus to see if he's going to heal on the Sabbath so that they might accuse him. But Jesus knew their thoughts. And so he asked them, is it okay to do good, to heal on the Sabbath? They don't say anything. So he tells the man to stretch out his hand. He heals the man, and they take counsel how they can put Jesus to death, or they could destroy him, arrest him. Now let's look at the same story as reported by Matthew. Jesus went on from there. That's from picking grain on the Sabbath. He went on from there and entered their synagogue. And a man was there with a withered hand. And they asked him, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath? So they might accuse him. He said to them, which one of you has a sheep, if it falls into a pit on the Sabbath, will not take hold of it and fill it out and pull it out? But here's the thing. Notice what happens here. It's the Pharisees this time who ask Jesus, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath? Remember, in Mark and in Luke, they don't say anything. They're there to see if he would heal on a Sabbath, but Jesus knew their thoughts. So what Matthew does is he changes this by creating this their thoughts and transforming them into an actual dialogue with Jesus. So again, we see Matthew doing precisely what he would have been instructed to do in these compositional textbooks. It was entirely proper for him to do it. And then after he heals the man, they go, and the Pharisees went out and conspired against him how they could destroy him. All right, let's look at another example. Let's look at Jesus' teaching on divorce. Now, here we have a comparison of how Mark tells the story with how Matthew tells the story. I'm not going to go through all of it, but in both cases, the Pharisees come up to Jesus and they ask him, is it okay for a man to divorce his wife? Now notice what happens here. I'm going to kind of color code these. Jesus in Mark says, well, what did Moses command? So he asks them a question. And the Pharisees answer, well, Moses permitted a husband to write a certificate of divorce for his wife. And Jesus replies, well, you know, that was because of your hard hearts that God permitted it. But, you know, it wasn't supposed to be that way. From the beginning, God made them male and female, and whatever God has joined together, let no man separate. Now, if you look at how Matthew tells the story, it's kind of interesting. So, when Jesus in Mark says, what did Moses command? Matthew has it as, well, haven't you read? From the beginning, God made them male and female. So it's a question and a question here. But if you look where Jesus says it in Matthew, it comes later in Mark. And when the Pharisees answer, well, Moses permitted, in Mark, it's a statement, but in Matthew, the Pharisees reply, well, why did Moses allow divorce? So you can see just by the color codes, you know, Matthew has Jesus answer because of the hardness of your hearts, but that's a little bit earlier in Mark. You see how things are split up. So If we take Mark in priority, as most scholars do, that Mark was the first gospel to be written, then we see Matthew taking this material in Mark, and he's altering it some. It doesn't change the meaning whatsoever. The meaning stays the same. But Matthew was doing what a good writer had been trained and trained to do in the compositional handbooks. You were supposed to do this with your sources. So let's look at the temptations of Jesus. Go on and look at another example. Now, this appears, the temptation of Jesus is reported in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, but Mark does not describe it at all. He just says he was led into the wilderness where he was tempted. But Matthew and Luke give it to us in detail. So the first temptation is the same in both. After 40 days, Satan comes up to him and says, "Hey, I know you're hungry, so why don't you turn this this stone into bread?" And it's interesting to note that in one gospel he says, "Turn this stone into bread," and in another gospel, one of the others, he says, "Turn these stones into bread." So he changed a singular into a plural or a plural into a singular, which was another thing that was taught that you can do. What's interesting is the second and third temptations are not in the same order. So in, let's say, Matthew's gospel, Satan takes Jesus to the top of the temple and he says, "Cast yourself off, and you know, as it's written, your angels will be given charge concerning you so that you don't even so much as dash your foot against a stone." And then he leads Jesus to a high place to look and shows him a bunch of the kingdoms of the world. And he says, "I will give all of these to you if you will just worship me." But in Luke's gospel, these, the second and third, are inverted. Now, whether Luke inverted the order, Matthew inverted order, don't know. One of them seems to have done it. So we can see this is just a slight change in the arrangement of content. Let's look at Jesus' baptism and notice some other just slight changes happening. Now, when Jesus comes out of the water, there is a voice from heaven that in Mark and Luke that says, "You are my beloved Son. In you I am well pleased." When we read the same in Matthew, the voice says, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." The difference here is that in Mark and Luke, the voice from heaven, God's voice, is speaking directly to Jesus. Whereas in Matthew, the voice is speaking to the crowd to testify to those there that the voice is witnessing that this is my Son. It's God speaking and he's saying, "This is my Son." So there was some change going on here. Probably Matthew changed. He redacted the words. Redact is just a simple but a kind of cool theological term to mean edit. So Matthew edits the words because he wants to use this as God's testimony to everyone that Jesus was his Son. So the meaning isn't changed, but Matthew changes the audience to whom God is speaking. Let's look at the transfiguration where something similar occurs. A voice comes out from heaven when Jesus is up on the mount and he's taken his three disciples with him, Peter, James, and John, the three closest disciples, and a cloud comes and surrounds them all. Jesus is transfigured into a glorious figure, and the voice of God comes out of the cloud in Matthew and says, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." But when we read the same thing in Mark, it says, "This is my beloved Son. Listen to him." When we read it in Luke, the voice says, "This is my chosen Son. Listen to him." And neither the voice of Jesus' baptism or transfiguration is reported. But so in Luke, "This is my chosen Son." So look at the differences here. It's pretty much the same in Matthew and Mark, except Mark doesn't have "in whom I am well pleased." So if Matthew is using Mark as his source here, then he is adding to the thought for clarifying. He remembers this perhaps at Jesus' baptism, and he's clarifying the thought. He wants people to know that God is well pleased, and God did said this on another occasion, as even Mark reported. Now, it could be that Mark is just selecting this, and he left off "in whom I am well pleased," or it could be that Matthew has added, as he would have been allowed to do, to communicate a thought that would have been true. It just might have been communicated on a different occasion, and perhaps even in a different way. But the big thing here is look how Luke has changed it. He actually changed the word from beloved son to chosen son. The son, or the word for beloved in Greek is agapetos, from agape, meaning beloved, but chosen from eklektos, meaning elect, select, chosen. Slightly different meaning here that Luke seems to be wanting to convey to his readers. But the overall message is the same, but you can see where Luke has nuanced the meaning a little bit of what God has said at the Transfiguration through substitution. Let's look at the parable of the sower here. Now, this is found in a few Gospels. And in this, Jesus talks about seeds being sown on different grounds. And some are sown on shallow ground, and it takes and it sprouts up quickly, but it doesn't have depth in the soil. And so the sun comes and it dries these plants up and they die. And Jesus talked first about it's scattered, but it has no depth, the seed, so the birds come and they pick it up. And then he talks about it, rocky ground. And then the third set of seeds are put down by the sower and is put in good ground. And these get in good soil and they grow up and, you know, they harvest 30, 60, and even 100-fold. And Jesus explains the parable by saying, okay, that which is just spread on the ground, but it doesn't, you know, it's just left. It has no depth. The gospel takes no depth. The seed is planted, but Satan comes along and takes the message away so that the people don't understand it. The second group of seeds fall onto rocky ground and they sprout up and they look like they're living. So they first receive the gospel and become followers of Jesus with joy. But then the cares of the world or persecution comes along and they abandon the faith. The third group of seeds have good ground and these follow Jesus. They believe the gospel, they follow Jesus, and they become fruitful Christians. Now here's what's interesting. When we look at the Gospel of Mark and read that, he says, and they yield 30, 60, and 100-fold. And when you come to Matthew, he just inverts those and says, they yield 100, 60, and 30-fold. And then when you read Luke, he just abbreviates, he subtracts, and he says 100-fold. So one, you can invert the order, you can add, you can subtract. We can see one of them, perhaps Matthew has just inverted the order, and then Luke has changed through subtraction, and he just mentions 100. Now, let's look at one more example, and this comes from the parable of the vineyard and the wicked tenants. Now, Jesus tells this in all three of the synoptic gospels. Unfortunately, we don't find it in John, so we can't compare it with that. Jesus tells the parable, he says, there's a vineyard owner and he sets up and builds this vineyard and gets it ready and then he leases it out to some tenants. And the way things worked back in those days in the first century is a wealthy person could do this, lease it out to the tenants, and at the end of the year, they would pay him with the first fruits, the best of all the crops, and he would get a portion, agreed upon portion, and that would be his payment, his profit from that, and then they could keep the tenants could keep and sell off everything else. So at the end of the season, the vineyard owner sends a servant and say, hey, okay, my boss wants, you know, the first fruits. And they beat him up and they send him away. So the owner thinks, well, maybe they just didn't understand him. So he sends some more. And they beat some of them up and they kill another one and send them back. And I says, well, this is kind of strange. And so finally, the vineyard owner says, I'm going to send my son. Surely they'll listen to him. And so he sends his son, and the vineyard owners say, hey, this is the owner's son. He is bound to get the inheritance of this vineyard. Let's kill him, and then we'll claim the vineyard as our own. So they kill him and cast him out of the vineyard. So then Jesus says, you know, what will the owner of that vineyard do? Well, he's going to come, and he's going to kill those tenants, and he's going to give the vineyard to others. Now, that's basic parable, and the meaning of that is that God sent prophets to Israel, and they rejected the prophets. They beat some, they killed others, and he kept sending these prophets, and the Jewish leaders would reject them. And so finally, God sent his son, and they said, okay, hey, we'll kill the son and the inheritance that is our Jewish flock and following, they will be ours. So in other words, they're not so much concerned about God's kingdom and God's thoughts. They just want to be the leaders and have all this power and prestige for themselves, what would belong to God. And so they kill the son and cast him out. And so that's why God says, hey, I'm going to destroy you guys and I'm going to give this vineyard to others, meaning the Gentiles. And the Jewish leaders get very upset at this. So that's how the parable goes. Now let's look at how all three of the synoptics tell the same parable differently. This is the same occasion, by the way. It appears in Matthew, Mark, and Luke on the same occasion. It's just after Jesus has cleansed the temple on Palm Sunday. And so, you know, that's when they come up to him, by what authority are you doing these things? And who gave you this authority? And Jesus starts to converse with them. And one of the things he does is he tells them this parable. So this is the same occasion. Any differences cannot be accounted for, this being different occasions. So let's see what's going on. In Matthew 12:9, after they have killed the son, Jesus says, what will the owner of the vineyard do? He will come and destroy the tenants and give the vineyard to others. So he asks and answers his own question. When we read the same thing in Matthew, Jesus says, so what will the owner of the vineyard, when he comes, what will he do to those tenants? They said to him, that is the Jewish leaders, the Pharisees that were there, well, he will put those wretches to a miserable death, and he will lease the vineyard to other tenants who will give them the fruits in their seasons. So what Matthew does here is he creates dialogue. He paraphrases, he creates dialogue. Instead of Jesus asking and answering his own question, he asks the question and the Jewish leaders answer it. So, and look at what the answer is. It's a little bit added and paraphrased of what Mark says. It doesn't change the meaning. It just makes it a little more dramatic, perhaps, pleasant to read. So this is what Matthew does to paraphrase. And we can see, again, he's doing exactly what the compositional textbooks would have instructed writers to do. A few more details can be observed as we look at this parable in all three Gospels. So Matthew starts off and he says, he sent three servants, and he beat one, he killed another, and he stoned another. And Mark says, well, he sent one servant, they beat and sent him away. Luke says the same thing. And then the second set comes up. Matthew doesn't mention another one because he already included three. So he has compressed the account. He abbreviated it. And by the way, you can see Matthew doing this more than, you know, we wouldn't know if Mark was doing it if he was the first gospel. But we do see Matthew doing this, these kind of things quite often, even more than Luke. So you see Mark, he mentions another servant. They struck him on the head. They treated him shamefully. Luke has basically said the same thing. They beat him. They treated him shamefully and sent him away. So he doesn't mention anything about striking him on the head. And then the next set, he sends another servant and they kill him. And Luke says the servant, they wound, they cast him out of the vineyard. So he doesn't get killed. But the idea here is they treat him poorly. So they're giving no respect to these servants that the vineyard owner is sending. And notice again, Matthew doesn't list one because he started off by saying the vineyard owner sent three servants. They beat one, they killed one, they stoned another. And then another set, Matthew says, and then he sent more servants. Next, he sent more servants than initially. So that would, we don't know how many, but more than three. It doesn't really matter here. The numbers don't matter. It's the parable. It's told differently. Jesus probably told it differently on different occasions, although this is being reported as the same occasion here. So he sent more than three servants, and they beat some, they killed others, they stoned others. Mark says that the vineyard owner sent many others, and they beat some, and they killed some. And Luke doesn't mention this set. Finally, all three say, finally the vineyard owner sent his son and said, surely they will listen to him. Matthew says they killed the son. Mark says they killed him, then they cast him out of the vineyard. And Luke says they cast him out of the vineyard, and then they killed him. So there's a swapping of the alternate order here. why did Luke do this? It could have been just to simply mix things up here, or to make it a little more in conformity with the death of Jesus, where they cast him out of the city of Jerusalem and crucified him there. So Luke might have altered it to do that. We just don't know. We can't get into their minds, but we can see that this was the typical kind of things that ancient writers were instructed to do. So I hope this has been helpful. What this seems to suggest to us is that when we are reading the Gospels, many of us, including myself, for many years, have thought that we are reading precisely what we would have seen had we been there, or if we had had someone who video recorded it and were then to write the watch the video, this is what we would have seen recorded precisely in the order of everything. But as we look carefully at the Gospels, we see this isn't the case. They are writing a gist of what occurred. Sometimes they alter the story a little bit, and they do it for various reasons. And in this video, we have seen that a number of those reasons are because this is indeed what they were trained to do.